give me joy that's unspeakable. And I like it, I like it, yeah. Your love for me is irresistible. I can't fight it, I can't fight it, yeah. If life is water, I was dry as Tucson dirt. If it's a gamble, I already lost my shirt. If it's a journey, I was dazed without a clue. I flipped you back to the first love I ever knew. You give me joy that's unspeakable, and I like it, and I like it, yeah. Your love for me is irresistible. I can't fight it, I can't fight it, yeah. You carried the cross and took my shame. I believe it, yeah. You shine a light of amazing grace. I receive it, yeah. If life's a battle, the invasion is complete. If it's a rhythm, I have found the perfect beat. If it's a renaissance, I've got a new birthday. The world don't give it and the world don't take it away. You give me joy that's unspeakable, and I like it, and I like it, yeah. Your love for me is irresistible. I can't fight it, I can't fight it, yeah. You carried the cross and took the shame. I believe it, yeah. You shine a light of amazing grace. I receive it, yeah. I'm bowed and broken, everything's new. All that I need, you're like water to seed. And how your love rights everything wrong. And in my weakness, you're ever stronger. You're pulling me back where I belong. You give me joy that's unspeakable, and I like it, and I like it, yeah. Your love for me is irresistible. I can't fight it, I can't fight it, yeah. You carried the cross and took my shame. I believe it, yeah. You shine your light of amazing grace, and I receive it, yeah. You give me joy that's unspeakable, and I like it, yeah. Your love for me is irresistible. I can't fight it, yeah. You carried the cross and took my shame. I believe it, yeah. You shine a light of amazing grace. I receive it, yeah.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to worship here tonight at Flame of Faith United Methodist Church in West Fargo. My name is Janson. I'm a worship leader here. I also am the administrative assistant, so I spend a significant amount of time in the office. Now, if you're interested in tonight's order of service with the scripture, the song lyrics, the prayers, go to our website, flameoffaithumc.org. And click on the button that says Order of Worship. It'll take you to a page where you can see the order of worship. And then there's a PDF file you can download. And that will have all the things I said, the scripture, the lyrics, the prayers, and just the order of tonight's service. I highly suggest you go do that. Now let me move us into a time of prayer. We'll start with a time of silent prayer. I will continue with a pastoral prayer. And then we'll join together in a slightly modernized version of the Lord's Prayer. It might be a little different than you're used to. The words will be on the screen or in that PDF file. But please, please pray it how you're used to. We definitely want to hear from you. If you have prayer requests, please let us know. You can call us, you can email us, any other way. You can text us. So please let us know. All right, let us pray. loving God. Jesus Christ is come. We sing for joy as we embrace him. Through so many days of darkness, we followed the light of the star and found the light of the world. Thank you for sending your Son to teach us, to guide us, and to show us the way. As we reach into the new year, help us to keep our focus on him and away from temptations that would separate us from you and from each other. All glory and power and honor and strength are yours. And so we pray together as Christ taught us. Our God in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Just as we bring forth our prayers, so too we come offering ourselves, our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. You can give through our website, flameoffaithumc.org/donate. You can also use the Give Plus app. Just search for Flame of Faith United Methodist Church. Or if you're more comfortable, you can mail a paper check. The address is on the screen. Now join me in praying over tonight's offering. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the gift and the giver of all good gifts. With gratitude, we thank you and return to you what is yours. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. I am Pastor Sara McManus, and I am excited to gather together in worship with you. Thank you to Janson for starting us off tonight in both song and prayer today. Our announcements this evening as we continue in our time of worship are that after worship tonight, there are no activities, no children's activities, and no youth group. This Sunday, for those families of confirmands, this Sunday there will be a confirmation class at 6 o'clock on Sunday night, and that'll be on Zoom. So those are the things that are planned. We are working to see what the rest of January will look like here at Flame of Faith United Methodist Church. So be looking for more information about our kids, our Flame kids. Be looking for more information about our youth group, adult studies, what's going to be happening with worship over the next few weeks. And thank you, especially a special thank you to everyone in the congregation for the Christmas gifts that you gave to me and my family. And I know that Janson reaches his thanks as well in the ways that you support and care for us and share your joy during Christmas. As you many of you know, we are still in the Christmas season, so we've still got all of our decorations up. It is called Christmastide. If you have never heard me say it before, the 12 days of Christmas begin on Christmas Day. So we're going to continue celebrating Christmas until January 6th, which is the date of Epiphany. I invite you now to pray with me this night. O God, searcher of all our hearts, you form us as a people and claim us for your own. As we come to acknowledge your sovereignty and grace and to enter anew into covenant with you, reveal any reluctance or lie within us. Let your Spirit impress your truth on our innermost being and receive us in mercy for the sake of our mediator, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Our scripture tonight continues Jesus' story, not as a babe, but as a child of 8 or even up to 12. It's not completely clear how old he is. But it's a story. Oh, no. Let me rephrase this because I'm going to read this in about 2 seconds. He's 12. This one we actually know. The story says it. It's a story of a child's curiosity mixed with the surety of the Christ. And so I invite you to look along with me on Luke 2, verses 41 through 56. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, sometimes, when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival has ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. But his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. They started to look for him among their relatives and friends, and when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to them, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." He said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he had said to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine and human favor. Here ends the reading. Before we get too much farther, I don't know about those of you who are parents who are listening, but I recognize every single step of this story. You know, when I first, the first few hundred times I have read this story, I thought, well, who would lose their child? You know, first of all, who would lose their child? And why wouldn't they know what Jesus was up to? And la-di-da-di-da and all of these arrogant non-parenting things that I knew, or, you know, parent of baby. But if I were traveling with a group of my family, I would assume that my children were not hanging out with me, that they would be with their favorite uncle or with grandpa because he's much cooler than I am. I can hear my son's voice saying, "Well, why didn't you know that, Mom?" This sounds like so many parenting interactions I've had that I know there have to be others that understand this story. But every year, so the story is that every year after returning from Egypt, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, they return to their lives as a typical Jewish family. You know, they lived in Nazareth. They returned and went to Jerusalem every year to celebrate the Passover. This is a tradition we see Jesus continuing into his adulthood. The return to Jerusalem for Passover is a journey of celebration and remembrance. And we have that precocious young Jesus reminding his parents of all the things that they taught him. It's like he's repeating back to them. "Well, didn't you know? You told me this was my father's house one time 12 years ago. Mom, where else would I be?" Sassy Jesus is my favorite Jesus, if you didn't know. But it's the promises and the stories we tell one another that we live up to. As we said when talking about the story of Mary's choices, she chose to have Jesus with eyes wide open to the difficulties he'd face. She needed to teach him to grow and be the Savior. So him coming to the temple and getting caught up in discussing God, not all that surprising. You see, each member of his family made promises to God that stemmed from their connection to the wider covenants of Israel. So Passover, of course, means a trip to Jerusalem. It's tradition. A tradition we understand in this season of traditions both kept and traditions changed this year. We are often traveling this day. Normally, Janson and I were talking about this morning. I'm normally not here this week of the year. I am normally gone on vacation. I am normally sleeping for days, probably ignoring my children and not knowing where they are. Ooh, scratch that. Anyway, we're normally traveling during this time of year, and some of you are traveling during this time of year. And this tradition of travel is a part of our lives most years. But this year, our traditions have changed, but the meaning behind them hasn't. We seek to live into the promises of faith and family, of community and connection. And for some of us, those promises meant staying home. And today, we're going to take a look at promises of faith, the covenants that we make with God as God's own disciples, as followers of Christ. Tonight, I invite you into a moment of promise in and of ourselves, the renewal of covenants. Tonight, we are going to tell the story of covenant, of promise, based on the covenant service from our own book of worship and Jeremy Smith of Hacking Christianity. It's a blog. He wrote a translation of Wesley's covenant prayer. These are prayers that are meant to be done yearly, to remember and to pray, to remind ourselves of the life we have promised to live as followers of God. It is a renewal of promises to ourselves and to God. Much of it comes from John Wesley himself and updated throughout the years, as I said. It's a renewal of our baptismal vows and those promises made at confirmation and when we join the church. If you have your newsletter handy, you'll see the prayer that we will pray together later in the service. But I invite you now to a time of prayer and covenant, of holy communication, open to God's guidance as this year comes to an end and a new one begins. This is a prayer that can be full of the hard promises of God, but a covenant that can hold us true to God in the coming year. And so, brothers and sisters in Christ, the Christian life that we live is redeemed from sin and consecrated to God. Through baptism, we entered this life and admitted into a new covenant in which Jesus Christ is the mediator. He sealed that it might last forever. On one side, God promises us new life in Christ, the source and perfecter of our faith. On the other side, we are pledged to live no more for ourselves, but only for Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself to us. From time to time, we renew our covenant with God, especially when we reaffirm baptism or gather at the Lord's table. Today, however, we meet as generations before us have met to renew the covenant that binds us to God. Let us make this covenant our own. It is a time of commitment. We give ourselves once more to the work of God, to the work of Christmas. For each of us, the work of God is different. For some, it is easy and honorable. For others, it is difficult and feels disgraceful. Some are suitable to our inclinations and interests. Others are called to more difficult pursuits. It is a time of commitment to more than ourselves. It is a denial of self that opens us to a life of Christ. We are joyful that Christ calls us to work and peace and place. You see, Christ does not force us to worship. To follow his call is our choice, our journey, our first step, and we confirm and enter freely. We seek God's presence in our lives through time spent alone with God, through seeking God's assistance and acceptance, through reminding ourselves of our promises to God, through searching our own hearts for sin, through seeking forgiveness, through choosing a life that has changed. We claim God's covenant as our own. We resolve to be faithful and dedicate our lives to God. And so we pray, O God, in all righteousness, that in our sinfulness we see our hearts in truth, and in your mercy we turn with our whole lives. We renounce our sin. We renounce the evil we find in the world. We renounce the temptations that we feel. You, O God, are our portion, our strength, and our salvation. In giving ourselves to you, we seek to live your ways in our world, your ways of righteousness and justice, of mercy and kindness. Guide us this day and in the coming year. Open our minds to your words in prayer. Open our hearts to your people in love, and open our eyes to your creation in compassion and justice. I invite you now to pray with me. This day forward, we covenant. I am not my own self-made, self-reliant human being. In truth, O God, I am yours. Make me into what you will. Make me a neighbor with those whom you will. Guide me on the easy path for you. Guide me on the rocky road for you. Whether I am to step up for you or step aside for you, whether I am to be lifted high for you or brought low for you, whether I am to become full or empty with all things or with nothing, I give all that I have and all that I am for you. So be it. And may I always remember that you, O God, and I belong to each other. Amen. As I said, I invite you to print this prayer. Put it someplace where you will remember it in the year. It is a hard prayer. It is a difficult prayer. It is a deeply honest prayer. As someone who has spent her life focused on God, the idea of stepping aside for God has always scared me every time I say that prayer. And yet, to make even that promise connects me even more with God. And so, in all things, we seek God this day. And as the year comes to an end, and as a new year comes to us, together we seek to live as God's people, doing God's work this day and always. I now invite Janson to come forward and sing for us. Love came down at Christmas.
please hear tonight's benediction. We embraced Christ at the manger, and now we hear his words at the temple. Let us renew the covenant and continue to follow Jesus. Amen.